This may be the final day of the long California winter. Cloudy, cool, still, but it looks like we're actually maybe coming out of it. We think. We hope. There's some beautiful, fragrant wood smoke coming my way. Some basketball practice here, some piano practice down the street. Some kids walking along the street in the evening time here in California. Now, we have four options. One is to be liberated in this life while we're still here. The second is to be liberated in the afterlife. The third is to have one more life. And the fourth is to indefinite, aimlessly wandering about in forlorn despair. Those are the four options we have. And so here, we're focusing on the first three options. To be liberated, Jivan Mukti, liberated while still here in the world. Very few will do that. It's tough to be a saint while you're still in the world, let's put it that way, to be liberated, yeah. Most don't want to do that. But we can be liberated after we decide to leave this world. Absolutely we can. And perhaps more will do that, and then there's even more who may decide to have one more life, okay? One more go-around. So as we practice here, those who practice very diligently can be liberated while they are still here. Still have a body, still functioning here. And those who practice, so-so, are looking to be liberated in the afterlife. And those who just hear what's being said, who are just listening but not practicing, they will be liberated in the next life, most likely. So that's what we're all about here. We're not dealing with anything other than those first three options. Fourth option, you're on your own with that one. Indefinite wandering and about in forlorn hope. Many will choose that option, still continue to, but that's not our concern at this point. So, our concern is practicing. We either practice very intensely, which is what I've been doing, or we practice, occasionally, we get going on the practice, or we listen and hear it and consider it. It's thinking like, someday I'm going to do that. I'm just not quite ready to do it yet, but I'm going to do that someday. Those are the ones that'll have one more life, most likely. And then that life, they'll get practicing very intensely and get after it. Or they may decide to practice so-so, and then in the afterlife, they will get after it a little more and be liberated there. It's only taken me like almost 50 years to come up with how to practice in the right way, because the doubt in this world is so extreme. It is so difficult here. It is so terrible here that just a simple way of practicing in an effective manner seems to elude almost everyone here. It is the most elusive of the elusive, actually. And what we do is we just state something in the perfect way. Say, I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. That's the practice right there. So you state, I don't have any pain. Wow. I've abandoned not having any pain. Wow. I don't have any pain. Wow. I've abandoned not having any pain. I feel perfectly at ease. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly at ease. Wow. Okay, just this practice is all anyone needs to do. That's it. But again, it's taken a lifetime to be able to find this practice. But those who find it and hear it are super blessed, because this is all one has to do. That's it. But what a nightmare to get to this. But I've been helped by the Dharma Kings, of course, we all have. And invoking them is how I got to this. And I called the heavyweights. I've been calling the heavyweights. Who are the, you know, they're all heavyweights. But if you really want to call on the heaviest of the heavyweights, with no particular order, but you might say Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Padmasambhava Longchenpa, like that. And you can weave any of them in you want to, first, second, third, it doesn't matter. But I got to a point where I said, you know, time to really call in the super, 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 super heavyweights. Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Padmasambhava Longchenpa. Okay, that's a heavy array. Or you can say, Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Ramaharshi Longchenpa. But I don't want to leave Padmasambhava out. So you're talking about Jesus Christ, you're talking about Anandamaya Ma, you're talking about Padmasambhava, and then you're talking about Longchenpa, who is really heavily responsible for tremendous success in this world. Those are super heavy, of course, and then actually finish it off with Ramana, 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 Ramaharshi. So Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. I like that. Okay, so Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. And so this is what I do whenever my mind seems to have a kind of a lull in practicing. I just go Jesus Christ, Anandamaya Ma, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. And just keep repeating that. Just keep repeating it. Keep repeating it. Keep the momentum going. And what they have done is lead me to this very simple practice. And I know that's all I need to do. I don't need to do anything other than that. I feel the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I have the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Just state perfection on any way you want to. It's not that important. It's just that you emphasize that I feel perfect. Wow. I've accepted feeling perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. Same evaluation for both extremes. Okay. And this practice helps us practice the mind, realize it's one or the other. There's no gray area at all. The gray area is wandering in hell, believing that there's some gray area between perfection and the abandonment of perfection is what we call wandering in hell. That's all we need to know. So the mind has to practice realizing it's a choice. I can either choose one or the other. There isn't some third option as far as gradually leaving perfection. There's no such thing, because as soon as we pretend to be abnormal, we feel abnormal. Okay. And the mind is trying to function in an abnormal way, but it can't. So it's pretending to function in an abnormal way, actually. But it's best not to do too much explanation. It's just best to practice. That's simple. If you can practice, practice. If you can't, then hear the practice, listen to it, and hear it, and start considering it. I've escaped all suffering. Wow. I've abandoned my escape from all suffering. Wow. I've escaped all suffering. Wow. I've abandoned my escape from all suffering. Wow. It's one or the other. So this practice keeps bringing this home, and this is absolutely key, absolutely key. Super simple. The mind has to get used to seeing it's either or. Either we're aware of our perfection, or we're pretending to be abnormal. That's it. And the mind is trying to function in an abnormal way, and it's trying to figure out how to do that. There is no way to do that. So it always says, well, just wait a minute, you know, wait, first I want to try this, and so it keeps trying, the mind is ceaselessly trying to fixate abnormality, to turn pretense into fact, and it can never do that. So all it's doing is pretending to be abnormal, pretending to function in an abnormal way. It's not really functioning in an abnormal way at all, actually. It's just wishfully thinking and in that pretending to be abnormal. The mind is not abnormal. It's still perfect. So I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Don't say I left it. So we have to get to this abandonment. Use this term. It's really all important. In other words, we totally turn our back. When we try to function abnormally, we totally turn our back on normal functioning in terms of our pretense. We pretend that we're not functioning normally, right then and there. It's instant, right away. It's abandonment. It's instant abandonment. Now, it's a pretend abandonment, but it feels like an abandonment, such as our creativity. So, we just say, I feel totally at ease. Wow. I've abandoned feeling totally at ease. Wow. So, state what perfection is like in every which way as you go about the day. You can, whatever comes up, just keep being alert for, like, wow, the peace of God is upon me. Wow, I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow, I've accepted the peace of God upon me. Wow, I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Same evaluation, blocking all evaluation so we become very clear. It's either or. There's nothing to evaluate. It's either or. And you can feel how this will work for you. There's no doubt about it. It's obvious. It's obvious. It's just a matter of doing it. So, really, it's so simple. And yet, rarely does anyone do this in the world. But we have to pick it back up and do it. And then we find out, well, because we're jittery, saying, I don't want to be enlightened. That's not really, not right now. Well, then in the afterlife then, okay, that's fine. But start aiming for that. Start doing it. And you might not do it as intensely as I'm doing it. But you'll find that you'll pick up momentum and pick up speed. And you know, at some point you might change your mind and say, yeah, you know, I think I will do it this life. But there's no pressure either way. So it's all important right now to be either practicing, either intensely or sporadically, or listening to someone practicing. One of those three. All important right now. We don't pay any attention to what's going on. I get plenty of reports from people who just tell me stuff spontaneously, and I just, that's, wow. And that I just turn into a practice right away. So I'm waiting at the store, and there's only one clerk, and I'm waiting for so long, and the clerk's just blah blah talking with this guy, and this guy's making all these phone calls, and I say, wow, nobody's gonna wait on me. And I said, wow, I feel perfectly at ease. Wow, I've abandoned feeling perfectly at ease. Wow, I feel perfectly relaxed. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly relaxed. Wow. I feel perfectly relaxed. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly relaxed. Wow. So instead of getting agitated, I said, oh, this is a great opportunity just to practice. That's all that it takes. All that it takes is just seeing everything as an opportunity to practice. So if you're feeling agitated, just think of the opposite. Like, I feel totally at ease. Wow. I've abandoned feeling totally at ease. Wow. And just groove your mind in this practice. You just do this, and you don't really need to even think about anything else or worry about how will I be enlightened. Will I? Yes, absolutely you will. But you know, who will do it? So we keep doubting because nobody does it. You see, so you say, well, I doubt that'll work. Well, where's the evidence it doesn't work? Okay, who has done it? Well, those who have done it, it has worked. This type of practice has worked. That's what works. And you can say, well, you know, there's other stuff that works. Well, right, this is like supercharged. Okay, this is supercharged for these times. This is specifically now for these times because we need to go really fast. We need to really just drop everything else and do just this. Takes your mind off the world beautifully. I've escaped the world. Wow. I've abandoned my escape of the world. Wow. I've escaped the world. Wow. I've abandoned my escape of the world. Wow. Don't worry about results. Just do it. Don't worry about results. The results will come. Just practice. Don't practice for results. Just practice. We hear some bad news and just say, wow, I feel perfectly safe. I feel perfectly safe. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly safe. Wow. So as my thoughts came up during the day, I started to some negative grooves started to try and push in. I just noticed them and said, okay, let me flip that script entirely. And I said, wow, I feel perfectly safe. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly safe. Wow. I feel perfectly safe. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly safe. Wow. And just practice like that. Easy. If you do it. But there's, if those who won't do it, well, they won't do it. That's all. There's nothing I can do or anyone can do. Nobody can be forced. If they want us to keep pretending to be functioning, be abnormal, functioning in an abnormal way, then they will keep doing that. That's all. Doesn't mean they're abnormal at all. They're still the mind. Their minds are still perfect. They're just pretending that they're abnormal. Try and see if they can have a new creation, separate creation. You can't. So there's nothing to say about it. It's just this right practice. That's all. That's necessary. I've abandoned all pretense. Wow. I'm sorry, that's the wrong way. That's a good example of the wrong way. Okay, so use abandonment in the second part of it, the negative part. So you say, wow, I've given up all pretense. Wow. I'm free. I'm free of all pretense. We use that. I'm free of all pretense. Wow. I've abandoned freedom from all pretense. Wow. I'm free of pretense. Wow. I've abandoned freedom from pretense. Wow. Like that. So use abandonment in the second part of it, which is the negative part. And the positive one, try to use like, I'm free. I'm free of suffering. Wow. I've abandoned freedom from suffering. Wow. I've accepted bliss. Wow. I've given up. I've abandoned bliss. Wow. I've accepted bliss. Wow. I've abandoned bliss. Wow. I feel blissful. Wow. I've abandoned feeling blissful. Wow. I feel blissful. Wow. I've abandoned feeling blissful. Wow. Just like that. Nothing else needs to be done. Just do it. Without looking for any results. Without looking for any results. Now, of course, this takes a lot of faith, doesn't it? And that's part of the difficulty. I have enough faith to do it. But it's taken a lifetime to build that faith up. But faith is contagious. Very contagious. That's why revivals happen, is faith is very contagious. We say, and so we call in the, right now we have to call in the true heavyweights. Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. And you can accent at the end with a little punch like, Manjusri, Jamyang Kensi, Chogi Lodro. Wow. Whichever way you like. But prayer is all powerful, which is right practice like this. And if you start feeling nervous, you can say Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He leadeth me. He maketh me to sit down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Wow. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Wow. I have no needs. Wow. I've abandoned having no needs. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. So that's all I'm doing. Just practicing like this. That and doing balance work, working out, balance work. I've started doing a lot of balance work now. Walking, trampoline, running on trampoline, walking, core work. Still working out, feeling sore and tired from that. But the balance work is really important. I'm doing a lot of that, a lot of that. You can get like a 4-inch PVC pipe, Schedule 40 PVC pipe. Get like an 8-foot or 6-foot piece, put it on some thick carpet or something like that so it doesn't spin too much, and just practice walking on that and seeing if you get better and better at that. This really engages your attention and you realize how to relax your ankles and feet and legs so the small muscles are able to move real quickly, and taking little steps like that, and you can find you get better and better at it. This helps you keep your balance. Helps you focus on how important it is to practice, to keep practicing, in this right way that we have here. And this helps us keep our balance during these, awful times, profane times, very profane times, to say the very least. The reports I get from people, I say, I'm not going to even repeat them. Yeah, it's just catastrophic times, to say the least. But that's okay. We can keep our balance through right practice. So I took a little break from all electronics. No computer, no camera, nothing, no electronics. Got a lot of stuff done. Spring cleaning is taking place and going well, and reorienting, getting ready for the long hot summer that's coming up. Right? Getting ready for that. Get ready to take refuge. That's going great. So I basically have done what I advise others to do. Followed my own advice. And that's what's been going on. I'm free of all concerns. Wow. I've abandoned freedom from all concerns. Wow. I'm free of all concerns. Wow. I've abandoned freedom from all concerns. Now, by practicing this way, when the feeling of peace of God, the perfection of basically normal mind, when we drop pretending to be abnormal and the feeling of normal mind comes upon us, we're prepared, we understand that we could go, we could abandon that. But what we do is, okay, I abandon it. Okay, fine. Wow. That's all. When we pretend to not be pretending, then we've experienced the peace of God, the mind in a normal way. We pretend to, we're so used to pretending, we can't really drop pretending yet. We're not, that's too scary for us. So what we do is we pretend to not be pretending, to not be abnormal. I'm pretending to not be abnormal. Peace of God is upon me. Wow. And then I abandon the peace of God. Wow. Okay. It's all just right there. I'm pretending to not be abnormal. We've been pretending to be abnormal, so now I'm pretending to not be pretending that I'm abnormal. But it's still pretending. But as you see, it's like a pretending that flips the script entirely. So I'm pretending to not be pretending to be abnormal. So that's how I started my day. Just said, I'm pretending to not be pretending I'm normal. So I said, wow, everything is so beautiful. But I'm pretending. I'm not literally seeing that, actually, but I'm pretending that I am. So I'm pretending that I'm normal. You might say it that way too. I'm pretending that I'm normal. Because I'm so used to pretending I'm abnormal, my mind's abnormal, mind's functioning abnormally. Now I'm pretending that the mind is functioning normally. So I just say I'm pretending, and so as if the peace of God is upon me. Like, wow, that street, you know, is so sublime, so peacefully sublime. Wow, that tree is so totally beautiful. Wow, everything I see is just seamlessly peaceful. Wow. Now I'm pretending it that it's this way, but this is the right way to pretend, because we need to keep the habit out of continuity, fear, familiarity, expectations. Keep the habit of pretending, but that induces normalcy, which is all there is to induce. We cannot really induce abnormality. It's impossible for the mind to be abnormal. We're trying to induce it through pretending, but it will never happen. But we can, so to speak, induce normality, because that's there to be induced, isn't it? It's there. So we can pretend to be normal, to be functioning normally. And we can practice at that. I know it may sound silly at first, but I tried at this party. It was wonderful. Didn't have any problem at all. So, wow, I see perfect peace everywhere. Wow, I see perfect peace. It's a pretending. And so you can pretend like that. Wow, I'm feeling perfect peace everywhere. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect peace everywhere. Wow. Okay? So it's just like that. Start by pretending to be normal. And so you say, wow, I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. So we don't wait for all our thinking and doubts to creep in. We co-opt all that and intentionally say, wow, I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. And then we go back to pretending that we're normal. It's like, wow, I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. So we're in control. You see, we're in control. This builds confidence in us. The mind feels very confident. Because that's what's really taking place. We either accept or we pretend to have abandoned. We either accept normalcy or we pretend that we're abnormal. So we abandon non-pretending of abnormality. We abandon normalcy into pretending we're abnormal. Just like that. It's abandonment. It's not a leaving. A leaving's different. A leaving is like you walk out of the door and sort of walking a little distance away. It's not like that. We abandon it. It's boom. It all vanishes in an instant. Vanishes. Gone. Without a trace. We don't know where it went. We just abandon it completely. And now we're back into pretending we're abnormal. Not normal. So there's no space between normal and not normal. Okay. There's either one, either we're normal or we pretend we're abnormal. Or we pretend we're normal. Okay, but we don't start out pretending we're normal. We're normal and then we just decide to try to abandon normalcy. That's a decision we choose. To abandon normalcy, we want to try and abandon normalcy to think we can create a different creation, and so then immediately we pretend to be abnormal. Immediately, instantaneously, directly, instantaneously, we pretend to be abnormal. There's no other step between that at all. There's no step between those two, and our problem is we keep thinking there's all these steps we took. No, there's no steps. It's instantaneous and direct. There's no steps at all. So, to hear this saves you thousands and thousands of years of suffering and more. To just hear this and to practice, there's no steps at all. It's instantaneous and direct. Direct and instantaneous. Direct and instantaneous. And so we just state that. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. See? Direct, instantaneous. This is where the mind is. Has to practice. Don't think this, practice it. The mind has to get used to not thinking about this, because thinking implies steps in between. Why else would we be thinking? If it was instantaneous and direct, then we know that we could get back instantaneously and direct. But we'd also realize we have a familiarity expectation issue. So we'd say, okay, for the sake of that, I will pretend to get back instantly and direct. I won't think about it. I'll state it. My pretending that I'm normal is instantaneous and direct. So, wow, I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. Instantaneously and direct. Wow, I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Direct. Instantaneous. And by practicing, we're pretending that we're normal. This is an exercise in pretending, because we are, again, the mind has been pretending for eons of moments, just so, trying to induce abnormality within the mind. The mind hopes that if it just keeps pretending to be abnormal, this will eventually will induce actual, factual abnormality, which is impossible. What God creates remains exactly unchanged, and God created our mind as perfect. And it cannot change. It cannot become. We cannot become. There's no such thing as becoming. There's no such thing as becoming at all. So there's nothing to undo at all. There's no becoming that needs to be undone. Nothing to be fixed. It's direct, instantaneous. There's no mediator of anything. Nothing to mediate. It's direct and instantaneous. We either are experiencing our normalcy, or we're pretending to be abnormal. Direct and instantaneous. Just a choice. That's it. Nothing else. Nothing to analyze. Nothing to think about. So the mind has to get used to seeing it this way. Used to seeing this way. There's nothing else the mind needs to do other than to really groove this. Just groove it. Like a record, you know, going around and around, putting that groove in it. Going over and over and over and over and over and over something just grooves it. It just grooves it. So you feel that you're just in that groove, effortlessly in that groove all the time, and you can't get out of the groove. This is a groove we don't want to get out of. We don't want to get out of this groove. We want to groove it through practice and stay groovy. Just stay in the groove. Wow, I feel perfect. Wow, I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. You just groove this. Don't look for results, just groove it. Grooving it is the result. Okay, grooving this is the result. In other words, going over and over and over, you're just grooving it in your expectations. And expectations are something rather subtle that we can't really see them, can we? But we can groove them, we can work on them like this. And so we just expect this is the way my mind functions. It just sees either or. It just sees either or. It's just a choice, either or. That's it. That's all there is to see. And that's, you want to be grooved in that way. This knocks out all analysis, all thinking, all conceptualization, all doubt, all struggle. It just knocks out that whole complex. Basically, our expectations. It shifts our expectations. The grooving it is the result we're looking for. And we just you do that just through repetitive practice in all different circumstances as you go about your day. And this is how you can spend the long hot summer coming up. That's how we can spend it. You see? Just like that. Just being groovy. Now, this is the 50th anniversary, I believe, 50th anniversary of the summer of the Groovy Summer of Love, 1967, which is the most famous summer in history, without a doubt. Started right here in the, it was something global, but it sort of mushroomed out of San Francisco, California. If you're going to San Francisco, be sure to wear some flowers in your hair. Yeah. All across the nation, such a new vibration. People in motion. Yeah, people in motion. For those. Scott McKenzie, San Francisco. So 1967, 50 year anniversary, 2017. And the mood is similar. The mood is similar. It feels chaotic. It feels turbulent. People are saying, you know what? Wow. Okay, so then what you were supposed to do is get your groove on, So what people did was they worked on being groovy, getting their groove on, which a new set of expectations. What happened in 1967 was kind of the new age thing started, of a new set of expectations. What we're doing now is not the new age, but the perfect age. Okay, the perfect age, the age of perfection. So we're getting our perfection groove on here. We're getting, not even age, just this is, we're getting our perfection groove on. That's all we're doing. We're getting our perfection groove on. It's not even we're new age, it's beyond new and age. It is perfection groove, the perfection groove. Getting our perfection groove on. And so this is the summer of 2017. Which we are about to really plunge into. Supposed to heat up here, high 80s, maybe next week, maybe, you know, high 80s, maybe 90, who knows, but it's going to be clear, sunny, warm, and we haven't seen that in about 6 months here. And full blast, somebody was just telling me, a friend used to hang out in a place that was super hot, 125 in the summer. And he was telling me how to survive all that stuff. He gave me all these tips about it. I said, wow, gets up at 4 in the morning. I've been getting up at 4 in the morning, waking up at 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, going to bed early, waking up early and practicing. I wake up, what do? I say, wow, Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. Wow, Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. Wow. Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. Like that. You just start calling upon them for help. What else is there to do right now? We don't spend any time floundering in how awful the things are. Forget it. We know that. We don't need to focus on it anymore. We spend our time calling for help, getting our perfection groove on. Now we may be all feeling very insecure. People are feeling very insecure. So we say, wow, I feel perfectly secure. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly secure. Wow. I feel perfectly secure. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly secure. Wow. I feel perfectly secure. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly secure. Wow. So we're getting our perfection groove on. The summer of perfection. Let's call it that. The summer of perfection. I don't know what kind of graphics to use. They used the psychedelic graphics, right? Back in the 67. The psychedelic posters. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I feel totally safe. Wow. I've abandoned feeling totally safe. Wow. I feel perfectly secure. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly secure. Wow. I feel perfectly secure. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly secure. Wow. Now you can slow that down. You know, it's up to you. Your practice is, you're the guru of your own practice. So understand this. In the summer of perfection, you're the guru of your own practice as far as the tempo of it, you know, exactly what you choose in terms of the I feel perfectly secure, I feel safe, I feel untouchable. Like, wow, I feel untouchable. Wow. I've abandoned feeling untouchable. Wow. You're the guru of your own practice. You could say, wow, I feel totally safe. Wow, I've abandoned feeling totally safe. Wow, I feel totally safe. Wow, I've abandoned feeling totally safe. But to start out, to start grooving it, I believe it's a good idea to alternate pretty quickly, just so your mind becomes very accustomed to this. And then you might want to space it out a little more. I don't know. That's possible. So you actually start feeling the feeling. Wow, I feel perfectly safe. Wow. Then after a while you say, wow, I've abandoned feeling perfectly safe. Wow. But to start with, to get used to this, try to alternate it. Like, wow, I feel perfectly safe. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly safe. Wow. I feel perfectly safe. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfectly safe. Wow. So you get really used to this, really used to this. So we're getting our summer of perfection groove on. 50th anniversary. Now, if you weren't there, I can tell you, being there in San Francisco Bay Area and actually traveling through the Haight-Ashbury district in the summer of 67, in a car, we were like gawkers, and there was a lot to gawk at. I mean, he's like, what? Like, it's like the Martians had landed or something. It was different than what our expectations, let's put it that way. It was different than anyone's expectations, but they didn't care. They didn't care. Shake your hair, dance like you don't care. That's what they were doing. And but they had a lot of communal, you know, it was a community, so they felt like empowered that way. But anyway, it was commotion. Commotion, 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 commotion. Feeling like everything is changing. Everything is changing. The whole landscape is irretrievably changing in every which way. Our expectations are just crumbling in every which way. And they did. But we didn't have right spiritual practice to handle it. So the backlash, you know, the backlash came. And we panicked and we started grabbing at straws, clutching at straws. See, we all walk this world in a forlorn despair because we think we can't return to what to normalcy, but we can't establish abnormality as a fact either. And so we're like zombies in no man's land is how we feel. We feel just forlorn, like we've been forsaken. We're forsaken and forlorn, and we're just wandering around. And occasionally this is punctuated by panic. And when we panic, we then clutch at straws. So the 60s really was a panic time where we panicked and said, wow, we just can't find our way back home. Can't find my way home. So and we panicked, and then we clutched at straws and says, help, 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 grab this, grab this, grab this, grab this. And we just tried to, you know, desperately grab whatever we could grab. And then we went back into sort of being forlorn again. But out of our pleas for help, some of it, you know, we made some real heartfelt prayers, and some momentum started to happen. Became aware of Padmasambhava, for instance, one of the you know, handful, you can count them on one hand, maybe, of the greatest helpers in history, for sure. Tibetan Buddhism would not exist as it does now. Maybe not exist at all. Well, it without Padmasambhava, yeah, it might not. It might not exist at all, actually. Not at all. Because Padmasambhava did the biggest turnaround, one of the biggest turnarounds in history, and we're benefiting from it now to a tremendous extent, actually. I'm benefiting to a tremendous extent from Padmasambhava. I didn't even know about Padmasambhava. And I guess that name was tossed out in the 60s, 70s a bit, and 80s, but it never really registered. And just recently, suddenly I became, you know, thanks to Longchenpa, I became aware of Padmasambhava a little bit, and then more and more and more, and I really began digging into it all. And maybe the greatest story ever told, what he did. Certainly one of them. One of the few, one of the very, very few. He's on the extreme short list of those who have helped the world the most, without question. Praying to Padmasambhava, I get extremely profound results very, very fast. It's a little, you know, kind of like, wow, to ask Padmasambhava for help. He knows how to turn it around. He's some action. You talk about someone who's decisive and certain and took action and got the job done. One of the greatest examples in history. And the foresight to understand that teaching needs to be refreshed throughout history. So he buried all sorts of treasure, mined treasure, buried treasure, all sorts of to be discovered later on in later centuries, to continually refresh the teaching, reinvigorate it. I mean, that's just, you know, a stroke of genius. It's awesome that he did that. And the Tibetans understand that. He set this example, Padmasambhava. For the Tibetans, they're not just one and done. When they help us out, the great ones, they know they're also going to refresh the help throughout the ages, throughout the centuries. And Longchenpa has done just that. He has repeatedly refreshed the teachings through mind treasure, mind stream attunement. So he's helped me out through mind attuning to his mind stream, empowering me with the experience of intrinsic spaciousness and awareness of that intrinsic spaciousness. That's how they do it. First is the empowerment, and then comes the view. First is the basis, and then comes the view. So then you develop a view about that, a viewpoint about that after. And that's what's happened with me. It's been over 3 years now, about almost 3.5 years. I've been developing the view on that, on intrinsic spaciousness, intrinsic awareness, the basis, reality, normal mind. So that's what happened. That's what Longchenpa did for me. And it's working. It's working great. So isn't that amazing? So it's not like you just come here and then you leave and that's it. They stay bodhisattvas, they compassionately attune to the world. They know what's going on. They know how to help us. They keep refreshing. They keep refreshing. They keep refreshing. Now, Jesus came back and refreshed us with A Course in Miracles. That's a refreshment. We needed it because we had lost the essence of the catechism, Christian catechism. The form is there, but we forgot what to practice. It's kind of like, yeah, we know we're supposed to practice, but we forgot what to practice. That's not good, is it? So now we know what to practice, this practice, the well practice. I've accepted, I've abandoned. I've accepted perfection, I've abandoned perfection. I've accepted perfection, I've abandoned perfection. Wow. I've accepted perfection, wow. I've abandoned perfection, wow. I've accepted perfection, wow. I've abandoned perfection, wow. That is the refreshed catechism for Christianity, for Tibetan Buddhism. It's all ecumenical right now. It's all ecumenical. We've transcended partisan viewpoints here. So we call upon Jesus Christ, Anandamayama, Padmasambhava, Longchenpa, Ramana, Ramana, Ramana. Okay, we call upon an ecumenical viewpoint, transcending any sort of religion at all, actually. We're not here to pick a religion of the past and say that we're doing this or we're doing that. No. I've accepted perfection. I've abandoned perfection. I've accepted perfection. I've abandoned perfection. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. Like that. We don't need to call that some sort of religion. It's just getting our summer of perfection groove on. So we can be liberated from pretending to be abnormal. It's that simple. So we can be liberated from pretending to be abnormal. It's that simple. It really is just that simple. It's simplicity that we've been in search of, actually. That's the toughest search of all. And I can tell you, it has been ridiculously difficult. But we have it. We have it now. So now it's the summer of perfection. Get your groove on. Get groovy with that. And that's taking refuge. And we're not rejecting any traditions either. Okay? See, we're including them. It's all inclusive. It's all inclusive, right? Two flowers here are symbolic of the tankas, the Tibetan tapestries, the way that like Longchenpa is depicted with two lotus flowers. Often they have like a couple, two lotus flowers, and he has a book on one and a sword, Manjushri's sword of wisdom and insight, prajna, insight coming from the next other lotus flower like that. It's a very nice. So we're inclusive like this. We're not rejective, but neither are we exclusive or are only this. You know, we're not like that at all, because we have the perfect practice. Really, I've accepted perfection. Wow, I've abandoned perfection. Wow, 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 I've accepted perfection. Wow, I've abandoned perfection. Wow. That's really the perfect practice. It's really the perfect practice. And all of the Dharma kings have been extremely helpful to get to this. They've all had played a big, major role, in this. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. I've accepted perfection. Wow. So these two flowers can symbolize for us This simple practice, this simple perfect practice. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. So anyone can get their perfection groove on, and I advise everyone to do so. Highly advise it. Absolutely, it's time to get this groove on. Okay, absolutely, it's time to get this groove on, and it's a decision. You'll just feel it in yourself. You decide, yeah, I'm going to do it, and then we'll see what happens. We had this lull. The Holy Spirit knew this lull was coming. It was a necessary lull. So we could take like one step back in order to take a leap forward. That's all it was, take one step backwards so that we could then take a giant leap forward, which is what we've done. We've taken a giant leap forward right now. So you will just know it, and you will just know it and say, yeah, that's it. Okay, let's go. Let's do it. Super simple. We're going to just see how if we can just stay within a context of super simplicity here. That's the toughest thing to do, of course. That's the whole battle, actually, is to repeatedly bring the mind back to, hey, you either accept what you are or you pretend to abandon what you are. That's it. There's no in between. There's no in between at all. And the mind keeps saying, no, I can do something in between. No, that would be abnormal functioning. Well, what is in between normal functioning and something else? There's nothing in between normal functioning of the mind. There's no in between. It's instantaneous and direct. So as soon as we think there's something in between, that is abnormal functioning, immediately and directly. That's all you have to know. Keep in mind that Sri Sri Anandamayaman never chose to function and pretend to function abnormally. Never. Very rare. So coming into this world was just simply an act of grace, not a decision to function abnormally. Very rare. That's an avatar. Never had any karma, never had any pretense to functioning abnormally, and never was completely aware that even though there was a play of functioning abnormally here, she was perfectly aware that she wasn't functioning abnormally at all. Okay. Super rare, super, super rare for that to ever happen here. So that's a heavyweight. Okay, that's a super, 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 you can't even express what a heavyweight Sri Sri Anandamayaman is. So that's why we certainly include her and call upon her. We know what a heavyweight Jesus Christ is, right? Padmasambhava, his actions here are legendary. Stupendous. Inexpressibly stupendous, really. And Longchenpa to clarify it and to be able to pull it all together. And how he did, he memorized all the sutras and all the tantras, all the books. He memorized all of them. So when he wrote, he didn't have any books. When he quoted stuff, it was all from his perfect memory. And he was able to get our attention. He was able to get attention in the right groove. Just right. Okay. Astonishingly difficult. And he's still working at it. So that he helped me. He said, hey, I want to help you get your attention in the right groove. I know you can do it. You just have to work at it. And so I said, well, I'll work at it and let's see, you know, let's see how it goes. Because you don't know how much you can groove it. It's not like an analytical result, like a 2 plus 2 equals 4. You just have to practice and groove your mind, groove your attention. That's all. So you just have to keep doing it and keep doing it and keep doing it. So I said, well, I don't know how well I can groove it, but I'll just try. That's all. I said, good, that's good enough. Give it a try. That's all you need to do. And that's all you need to do. Now, we can toss in a few simple tidbits also in this practice. I don't want to make it too complex at the moment, but there's a few others that are profound that I've been doing that are just one-line practices. I do not know what I am. Wow. I do not know what I am. Wow. But this must be said in joy without fear. And I've been able to do this. I've been able to do this. This is what Jesus' advice is. Simply says, simply say, I do not know what I am. I do not know what I am. I do not know. I just do not know what I am. Because what I'm freedom. How can I know what I am? How can I know anything? I do not know. I cannot know myself what I am because I'm everything. I'm freedom itself. Freedom is freedom in every which way. So I cannot know what I am. I can only experience. So, I do not know what I am. And Jesus says, when we can say this in a positive, celebratory, like, wow, this is great. He said, the wind of God is like spreading your wings, and the wind of God will be beneath your wings and lift you up higher and higher, higher into inexpressible glory. And he says, that's all you need to do. Just have that. It's an attitude to be able to feel this way. I do not know what I am. Wow. This world can never tell me what I am. There's nothing about this world that can ever tell me what I am because I'm nothing at all. I'm nothing at all. Wow, I am nothing at all. So these can be tossed in as we groove, but we want to make sure that we practice this. I accept perfection. Wow, I abandon perfection. Wow, I accept. I do not know what I am. I abandon the declaration. I abandon, how would we say that? So it's a little tough how we say that, but I accept that I do not know what I am. Wow. I abandon the acceptance of I do not know what I am. Wow. I accept I do not know what I am. Wow. I abandon the acceptance of not knowing what I am. Wow. You see that? Have to practice so we're in control of our acceptance and abandonment, acceptance and abandonment. It's not happening to us, you see. We think something made it happen to us. No, our expectations are what makes it happen to us because we have been pretending, trying to pretend. We've been a bit trying to abandon reality. So we're the ones who are choosing to abandon reality. Nothing is making that happen. So we must state that we are choosing to abandon it, choosing to accept it, choosing to abandon it, choosing to accept it, choosing to abandon it. Have to do it like that. Get used to realizing it's a simple choice, that we're totally in control of this simple choice, totally in control of this simple choice. Here's an example of getting your perfection groove on. I started to walk. I haven't walked for a long time. And at first, it was like, first I overdid it. I said, I can do this. So I started walking real fast, like a speed walker. Say, it's easy. I got it. But then next day I felt, terrible. So sore. I said, oh my gosh. It wasn't so easy. And so then I tried again later. And this time I sort of just walked at a brisk pace, you might say, just a brisk pace, like normal brisk pace. I went a little better. And then later on, I tried it again, and this time I tried to walk very straight. See if I can walk straight, and like on sidewalks they have those two squares, side by side kind of, and then so I tried to walk down the middle of the sidewalk just perfectly, and I realized I had all sorts of troubles. I said, wow, and then later, I tried and I got better and better. So now I'm able to walk better and better and better. So I'm getting my walking groove on. So it takes a little while. At first, you maybe you'll try too hard, and then you'll backlash, and then you'll go at it again. And I'll keep working at it. Now it feels like my walking is real, kind of brisk and smooth and steady, because I'm really putting my attention on the walking. Like, where's my balance? Am I wobbling? Is it a smooth walking, or is it kind of, ragged? And you begin to notice, and then adding, like, as I walk smoothly and steadily in a straight line, can I look up at the sky? Can I look at the trees? Can I look at the bushes and flowers and birds and look down the street this way and that way, and still keep that smooth, steady, balanced walking? And so I've been adding that to it. So just kind of gliding along in a nice, steady, real steady, beautiful gait. And it's fun. I enjoy it. And then, of course, practicing as I walk, doing this practice as I walk. Like, wow, I feel like I'm perfectly flowing here. I feel that everything is just a flow. Wow. I've abandoned feeling the flow. Wow. I feel the flow. Wow. I feel the perfect flow. Wow. I've abandoned feeling the perfect flow. Wow. I feel the perfect flow. Wow. I've abandoned feeling the perfect flow. Wow. So you add something on as you get more and more used to it, so you can walk and practice like this. Walking smooth, walking steady, walking with your attention, able to focus on the distance instead of just straight at your feet. Keeping your head up, smiling at people as you pass them by, and wow, I feel in a perfect flow. Wow. I've abandoned feeling in the perfect flow. Wow. Okay, it's a choice. It's a choice. It's nothing that happens to us. Okay, it's a choice we make. Pretending to be abnormal is nothing but a choice. Nothing causes that to happen. Nothing causes pretense to happen. It's our choice. There's nothing outside other than our choice that has any causative nature whatsoever. Nothing at all. But it's pretty simple right now. Most everyone should feel, and I'm getting reports from people suddenly realize, hey, the summer of 2017, I gotta make a choice about how am I gonna handle this? I mean, what kind of groove am I going to have? A groove of fear, a groove of confusion, a groove of turmoil, a groove of panic, a groove. It'll be easy to go into panic the summer of 2017 and going forward. Very easy. So we want to block that panic. It's all about blocking that panic. Because when we mind goes into panic, we start clutching at straws and fixating upon this, and then we start inducing really bad habits that can last a lifetime and are very difficult to break later on. I've been through it. I got into bad habits during the 67, starting 67. I got into bad habits. I panicked. I mean, nobody, knew how to help. And so I started searching at that time. I was 11 years old. By the time I was 12, I realized I had to get out of this panic and bad habits. And that's when I started my intense sadhana, spiritual practice, when I was 12 years old. 1968 is, I remember committing to it at that point, and sitting in a classroom and just deciding, okay, I'm committed to this. And at that, right then and there, that was it. My whole life, everything shifted, and I've been absolutely all in, totally focused on it for 48 years, nonstop. Because really, the turmoil can pull you out of simplicity. Before that, I was able to have a clear mind. My mind was very clear when I was young, So much so that I had natural foresight. Longchenpa says that when your mind is very calm, it's calmed down, and the ripples, all the hope and fear, and the ocean of samsara, of hope and fear, of trying to find some sort of gap between normalcy and pretending to be abnormal. When that all calms down, foreknowledge automatically arises as one quality of the mind. And so I was just effortlessly aware of the future, what was going to happen when I was young. I didn't even have to try. It was just effortless. I could sit here and just explain to somebody what's going to happen, you know, later on. And so yeah, this. And I'd do that. People would ask me, what's going to happen? It's kind of like a game. We had fun as kids. We thought it was all fun, you know. And I'd just say, yeah, okay, this is what's going to happen. This. And exactly what that's what would happen. It was just easy and natural for me. But when we began to get started with the British invasion, but then that built up into the summer of love to 67, and then things just started spinning out of control. And by the time of Woodstock, August of 69, and then things got really dark after then. It was just like all the wheels came off. And so I was, you know, just, by that time, I was just lost. I had lost my, you know, dharma, my dharmic clarity. Because everybody was, everything was just shifting, and people were just desperately trying to grab a hold of bits and pieces and hoping that that was it and fixating on it. And it's very dangerous when that happens, when the mind tries to get free of being forlorn, but it jumps into a panic mode. It doesn't know what to do, so it panics. It just, you know, oh my gosh. It's like they realize their house is on fire, but they don't know where the exit is. And so they just are climbing the walls, right? Just, it's like that. It's like a desperate person. The house is on fire, but they've forgotten how to get out of the house. And so you'll try anything under those circumstances, right? You'll hide under the stairs. You'll stick your head in a toilet. You'll try to climb out this window. I mean, just whatever. You'll do just anything and everything. It's bizarre, right? You grab a doll and hug it, you know. You beat your head against a wall. You maybe try to go into some yoga, upside down yogic posture. You'll start singing and dancing, hoping. Meanwhile, the house is burning down. You have to know where the exit is. If you know where the exit is, you just calmly and briskly just go out the exit. And, okay. Meaning the exit's right. Right practice, right spiritual practice is the exit. So we have the exit right here. So we're calm, not a problem. I've accepted perfection, I've abandoned perfection. I've accepted perfection, wow, I've abandoned perfection, wow. I've accepted perfection, wow, I've abandoned perfection, wow. Just this practice, that's the straight and narrow way to exit the burning house. Now, most certainly, the house is about to be on fire. There's no question about it. I won't go into particulars. People don't like foreknowledge. They don't like it. Okay, so I've tried to cut that out, but it still happens. I've had some dreams that have told me stuff that is just wow. I won't repeat at this point, but let's just say we need to find our way out of a burning house. It's very simple. Just go out the door. I've accepted perfection, wow. I've abandoned perfection, wow. I've accepted perfection, wow. I've abandoned perfection, wow. The mind just knows, oh, okay, yeah, that's going to work for me. So let's just go with this and easy exit out of the burning house like that. Not a problem at all. But again, but with the experience that I've been through, I know you have to do this. You do not want to be adrift, not knowing what to do, because you will be seized in every when people panic, they seize upon you. And it's horrible, it's alarming, it's shocking. You have to already be committed. If you're committed, you're committed. I'm committed to this simple practice, that's all there is to it. End of story. I'm just getting my perfection groove on. I know this. I know the turmoil's coming. I know what to. I know the house is going to burn down. I know the exit, the way to get out of the house. Very simple. End of story. And others will say, "Hey, come beat your head against the wall with me. You know that's what I'm doing. And if you do it, I know that'll work." No, it won't work. It won't work. Just having me, you know, do something that it's a logical, it's a panic absurdity. Logic happens in panic, absurd logic. It's like saying, like, let's say, "Hey, if Jesus comes and does what doesn't work, it will work." No, it won't. Jesus doesn't have any power to make abnormality normal. Or let me put it this way, make it a fact, make abnormality existent, a fact. Jesus has no power to make abnormality a fact. Can't do that. Jesus can't change the mind. No one can change the mind. So if you're saying, "Oh, the way to do it is to, you know, get out of the house and beat my head against the wall," having Jesus be there beating his head against the wall, that's not going to get you out of the house. But people think, "Well, Jesus knows the way, and if he's doing what I'm doing, that must be the way." So this is how the mind functions when it's in panic. It has faulty logic. Yes, Jesus doesn't know the way, but if you keep believing that he's his mind is acting abnormally and doesn't know the way, then in your mind Jesus doesn't know the way. And so it doesn't work for you like that. So you can't have somebody who knows the way join in what doesn't work and then claim, "Well, because they know the way, this must work." So it's a very tricky, it's obvious if your mind is clear, but if your mind isn't clear, we keep falling into this trap. And in a panicked world, there's a very dangerous trap that happens. They just think that if you know the way and then you join in with them, what they're doing, that will make it work. No, it's not that we know we can make anything work. It's that we know the way that does work. And we know that other stuff doesn't work, okay? We know it doesn't work, and we know it does work. We know the difference. So we're calm because we know what we're doing, what works. We're not calm because we're doing what doesn't work. Beating your head against a wall doesn't get you out of the house. Burning house, that doesn't work. So we're not doing that. But when those are in panic, they can't understand that. They want whatever they're doing. They're fixated because they're panicked. They don't know what to do. So they just say, "Well, I've got to do something." And they think, "As long as I'm doing something, that's better than doing nothing. And then if I get someone else who's calm, knows the way to do the same thing I'm doing, magically, that should work. I hope," they say, "I hope that'll work." They hope. It doesn't. It doesn't work. But you can understand their desperation. It's sort of the logic of panic desperation. I got to do something, and then I have to do whatever I'm doing. I don't know what else to do, so I have to. This has to work for me, even though it doesn't work. And so that ends up in severe fixation. And then they spiritualize it. They say, "Well, I just kind of, if you can come, you know, it's kind of like someone's beating their head against a wall and burning house." And they say, "Well, if you can just come in and like spiritualize it for me, that should work." If I can just, you know, wear the right clothes and say the right words and talk about teachers and, you know, spirituality, if I just do the whole spirituality trip, that will work. No, it won't work. Notice our practice doesn't include spirituality. It doesn't really have to. We'd say, "I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow. I've accepted perfection. Wow. I've abandoned perfection. Wow." It's really denuded of the whole spirituality trip, isn't it? Yeah, if you say, bang, you're hitting your head against the wall, and you say, "Anandamayama, bang, Anandamayama, bang." Yeah, she may help you by saying, "Hey, that doesn't work. Try this. You know, I've accepted perfection. Well, I've abandoned perfection. Well." But if you keep banging your head against the wall, don't get out of the house. Calling on her, it's not going to work. She'll find some way to get you to stop banging your head against the wall. Yeah, but you have to shift what you're doing. So she helped shift me out of the whole spirituality thing that's online. It's just so overwhelmingly prevalent. You're not going to get anywhere that way. That's what people did in the 60s. They grasped a hold of all the spirituality, and look where we are now. Right? We're up against it because that was just a fixation, a panic fixation. Massive complexity still there. Missing the whole point of practice, which is zero complexity. Direct, instantaneous. Either I choose to accept that my mind is normal, or I choose to pretend that it's abnormal. There's no complexity to that at all. Zero. Zero complexity. You could say I have zero merit for any complexity. I have zero merit for complexity. Spirituality is the belief you have some sort of merit. That you're accumulating merit. But the truth is, there's no merit to accumulate. How can a normal mind need to accumulate merit? And how can there's no abnormal mind. It's pretense. So we don't need any merit at all, actually. I know that the practice of Mahayana, the accumulation of merit. But what it really is reshaping your expectations so you can realize you don't have any merit at all. You're zero dimensional. Everything's instantaneous and direct. What need do we have of merit at all? When in Chandra Sering Chodron, the Tibetan Dakini appeared to me, that was the insight that I ended up having. Is she said, "What are you doing trying to accumulate merit?" I mean, that was that I realized that was the clarity that she brought. He said, "You don't need any merit. Nobody needs any merit. That's Dzogchen. That's the truth. That's." And of course, that flies in the face of Buddhism, doesn't it? I was thinking that you're accumulating merit, but what you're really doing is you're reshaping your expectations towards right practice, effective practice. And it's just a figure of speech saying you're accumulating merit. But that does bring in some trouble of believing that. But if you just say, hey, I have zero merit to be sick, I have zero merit to be abnormal, I have absolutely zero merit to be abnormal. So I can't be abnormal, can I? I'm a zero merit being. It's true, I am a zero merit being. But what merit do I need to be as I am, which is normal? What merit do I need to be as God created me to be? I don't need the slightest merit at all. So that's why in Buddhism, some Buddhism is at odds with Dzogchen. Because they say, no, you really need merit. You need to, this gradual merit building process and stuff. And Dzogchen says, and actually, you need to practice stating, I don't have it. It's impossible for me to have any merit at all. I can't have any merit. Because as soon as you bring that into play, you're bringing gradualism into play. You're precluding direct instantaneousness, which is normal mind. You're inferring that mind is abnormal in some way, has become. You're inferring some degree of becoming, and you have some merit to overcome that becoming. It's inferred, and they say, well, that blocks you from liberation in this life. It blocks it. So, what time is it? Oh, it's that late already. Okay. So I'm wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. I'm perfect. Wow. I've abandoned perfect. Wow. I feel all this perfection. Wow. I've abandoned feeling that all is perfection. Wow. I feel all this perfection. Wow. I've abandoned feeling that all is perfection. I feel perfect, wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect, wow. I feel perfect, wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect, wow. Just that. So we are going to work on grooving this. 217, the summer of grooving perfection. Summer of grooving perfection, groovy perfection. The summer of groovy perfection. Summer of perfection. And we're getting our groove on with that. Getting our groove on with that. Wow, I feel perfect. Wow, I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow, I feel so perfect. Wow, I've abandoned feeling so perfect. Wow, I feel so perfect. Wow, I've abandoned feeling so perfect. Instantaneous and direct. Instantaneous and direct. That is how the mind is, with zero merit required. That is how the mind is, instantaneous and direct. There is no other functioning of the mind at all. Totally impossible. And we're still functioning instantaneously and direct right now in our pretending to not be functioning instantaneously and direct, but functioning in an interdependent way, which is just an illusion, actually. This whole interdependent causation is just an illusion. Everything is still instantaneous and direct. All experiencing is still instantaneous and direct. Wow, how about that? Wow. So the wind has died down. It looks like it's actually, is it clearing up? It might even be clearing up. I don't know. But we're supposed to get clearing finally here. And I think we'll probably all complain that it's too hot. I'm sure we will. Wow, it's so hot. What's going on here? I don't know if I can take this. I actually ordered some salt tablets online, and I'm going to make sure, as the heat builds and I exercise, I'm going to make sure I stay hydrated. And because, I mean, we're not used to. It's been 6 months with cool, cold weather. Stay hydrated. Stay hydrated. Stay healthy. Stay in shape. Keep practicing your balance. Keep practicing your balance. That tube I got is really great. It's tough. Really, I have to really bear down. Really bear down on it. Don't do anything on a hardwood floor or a hard surface at all. Stuff can take off on you. Do it on a soft, yielding surface like a rubber mat or something where it won't spin on you. If you whatever you do with balance, be very careful. It's not on a hard surface. And that your toes can touch or your heels can touch, like a 4-inch pipe. Your toes, you start going forward, your toes can touch, and you go backwards, your heel can touch like that. So you're minimizing a risk with that. But it's very helpful to be working on your balance right now. Because, again, who knows which way everything's going to spin? There's going to be massive spin. It's already happening, of course, but massive spin doctoring in every which way. Okay. And so you have to be able, as like, log rolling, like the people used to navigate all these logs down the rivers. They used to put all the logs and cut the logs, put them in rivers, and then you have these those who would they'd walk across all these logs and they'd undo all the jams in the logs. The logs got jammed up, log jam. They'd use these long kind of pikes on long metal pikes that would they'd put push this log here and push this log here and undo that. That's their job. And the logs would roll in the water. They start spinning. And they actually have contests of log rolling, where you get two guys in a pool with these logs, and they practice, trying to. They both stay on the same log, and they try to get it spinning one way and spinning the other way, and they're trying to get the other to spin off into the water. So, we practice experiencing spin that sometimes this like 4-inch PVC, well, kind of can spin if it's on a sort of a some sort of surface. That sometimes it can start spinning, and you got to kind of make sure you You step, mini steps, to quick little cat steps to stay on top of it. So you want to be able to physically feel confident about handling spin and handling, whoa, it's going this way, now it's this way, now it's this way, now it's that way. Psychologically, that's very helpful. Being able to walk steady in a nice steady line, being able to walk well, that's helpful too. Very helpful. Balance, walking. It's very simple exercises right now. Keeping your balance, very, very helpful, because everything is going to be throwing us some spin at us right now. And for most, too much, they'll go in the water, which is the ocean of hope and fear, which is panic. They'll go into the water of panic. But we don't have to do that. We really don't. Those who just decide, okay, I'm committed to this. I'm going to commit. Let's see what happens. It's all just see what happens. I'm just committed. Simple. So it's just simple. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. I feel perfect. Wow. I've abandoned feeling perfect. Wow. Groove this practice. Groove this practice. Groove this practice. And then you can say that you were groovy in 217. You started being groovy in 217. And you don't have to wear a flower in your hair. You might have a flower on either side of you like this. I don't have any hair to wear a flower in right now. Got a summer cut getting ready for summer. It's going to heat up for sure. Salt tabs, short hair, and right practice. That's the recipe for being groovy in 217. Wow.